الحمد لله وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد. Welcome to episode 3. I'm very excited because I feel like we're getting the pieces of the puzzle together to create the final result and the final picture. I see in, based on some of your comments that it's a serious challenge that we all are facing. And before we speak about implementation, let us at least share the knowledge and the content, and then inshallah we make an effort and hope Allah facilitates and blesses us in implementing them in our lives. So we were at the 10th point, and there was a continuation for that one. Among the things we should teach our children are what are the different categories of Tawheed. And I cannot stress this enough, brothers and sisters, the importance of Tawheed, knowing Rububiyyah, the Lordship, Al-Uluhiyyah, the right of Allah to be worshipped alone, and Asma' al-Sifat, the names and attributes of Allah, is fundamental. This is what differentiates us from every other religion, from every other ideology, from every other deviant sect. The fundamental thing that differentiates us from all the deviance and misguidance in the world is our proper understanding of Allah's names and attributes, our worship of Allah alone and not associating any partners with Him, knowing who Allah is as our Lord and Creator. And I've been listening recently to all these different debates, you know, with these Muslims who turned atheists. And yani, wallahi, I cannot put it in words, the amount of, with all due respect, the amount of stupidity that a human being can stoop to is just beyond words. And they think they are intelligent, they think they got something going on. These people never knew Allah. They never knew Allah. You know where you can deny the existence of Allah, you know, with all the evidences around you. And so you have to be concerned about that as well. And then of course they should know what is the consequence of shirk, what is the consequence of hypocrisy, what is the consequence of disbelief and things of this matter. So they should know the matters of Tawheed in detail and their byproducts, and the matters of shirk and their byproducts, because this is fundamentally what will be their source of salvation in this dunya and in the life to come. Now that we have concluded the discussion on Aqeedah, and again we always begin with Aqeedah because Aqeedah is the most important thing, hands down. Ibadah, akhlaq, everything else is a plug-in to the base. The base is aqidah. If that is sound, then you can plug and play as much as you want. If you don't have that foundation, you don't have that board, you're not plugging anything, you're not getting anywhere, you're not benefiting in any way, shape, or form whatsoever. So that's where the focus should be, on aqidah. Once the aqidah is sound, then we could shift to ibadah. Ibadah is worship and servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The children should know the five pillars of Islam. You could take a time out right now and call them to you and ask them if they can enumerate the five pillars of Islam. If they don't, it's emergency. Do something about it, like right now. Then they should also learn about Salah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Muru abna'akum bis salati wa hum abna'u sab' wa adribuhum alayya wa hum abna'u 'ashr wa farriqu baynahum fil madaji'a kama qala sallallahu alayhi wasallam, command your children to pray at the age of 7. And beat them, and that beating is not that you show your son that you are Mayweather or Mike Tyson and you knock him out cold, but in the sense that you keep him in check to make sure that they pray at the age of 10, by the time they reach age of 10. Now here's a critical matter. A lot of people calculate this according to January, February, March, April, May, June, July, so on and so forth. Wrong. Because there's a major discrepancy, at least a 15-day discrepancy between the Gregorian year and the Hijri year. So that the child actually reaches the age of 7 in the Hijri calendar, perhaps a few months before the Gregorian. So be mindful of that and make sure that you stick to the Hijri calendar. And when you have to teach them the Salah, it's not that you say, pray. No, they have to know how to pray. A lot of brothers bring their children to the masjid and their children are clueless. They shouldn't be in the masjid to begin with. They're just a source of distraction. We got to be mindful of that. 13th, take your son with you to the masjid like I mentioned, but you have to monitor him. You have to moderate his presence in the masjid. If he's going to be a nuance, if he's going to be a source of disturbance and annoyance to the people, then he should not go to the masjid. And before he learns how to pray, he should know how to make wudu. A lot of brothers just bring their children to the masjid and he makes his son stand in the row and his son doesn't even have wudu. According to some of the scholars, this child just broke that line. It broke that row because he's a person that whose salah is invalid, therefore affecting the salah of everybody else. And so, you know, teach your son how to make wudu, make sure that he's doing the wudu properly, and then you teach him salah and it's, you know, arkan and wajibat and sunan, the shurut al-salah, the conditions of the salah, the articles of salah, the pillars of the salah, the obligatory acts of the salah, and the recommended acts of the salah, and what nullifies that, and when do you do the sujood of prostration, and so on and so forth. 14th, they should also learn the etiquettes of the masjid in general. And that whether they go in with you to salah or whether they are present in the masjid is fundamentally not a place of play. Yes, there's some leeway. Some of the companions had wrestled in the masjid, so there's a time for this and time for that. But for children to be going to the masjid and just wreaking havoc and disturbing the people, some of them just urinate in the masjid freely, and the parents just are paying no attention to that. Some children bring their food and drink and they make a complete mess, especially in Ramadan. It's heartbreaking. And, you know, the parents are like, yeah, bravo, my child, such a cutie. No, your child just ruined the masjid and the salah for hundreds of worshippers. 15th, teach the children and train them on to fast. Fasting, of course, they don't have to fast until they reach the age of discretion or they've reached puberty. But the Sahaba used to train their children to fast from a younger age so they can be familiar with it, so that it's not, the impact on them is not too painful once they start fasting. And so you train them from a younger age, you try to have them go as many hours as possible, you distract them with something to keep them, you know, fasting until the time of breaking the fast. 16th, surely you should encourage your child to memorize as much of the Quran and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the honor associated with that for the parents is beyond words. Well, there are words, there are descriptions of the Prophet ﷺ about the honor that the parents will receive on Yawm al-Qiyamah because of their children having memorized the Qur'an. And so there's a great benefit in the children memorizing the Qur'an and surely, and of course, acting upon it. And the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, make some time for that, allocate some time for that. We all need to do that actually. We are all negligent in this regard. And there's area for improvement, so let us work on that, inshallah. We will conclude with this, and in the next episode, we will discuss some further matters pertaining to ibadah, and then we will enter into the discussion of akhlaq and morals and character. Jazakumullah khair, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.